Hey, everybody.
What the? I'm back in the new room.
I used up all my reviewer points in the last two episodes. In a food ninja? When did that happen? Oh, well. At least I still have enough time before Magda. How long are you going to stand at my door for?
A little bit.
The show must go on. Welcome to Full Moon Month. Time-honored tradition that is missed today with a lot of video rental stores going extinct. The in-home date. Sure, you can probably go to the cinema, treat someone out to a nice little matinee, but why not stop by your video rental place, grab a couple of flicks, nice little pizza, kick back, and whatever you chose would be quite the surprising event.
So what do you have in mind, Fox?
Well, I was thinking about you be kicking back at a little gothic horror romance.
Ooh, Phantom of the Opera?
Close, but not exactly. Somewhere in that vicinity, though.
The Pit and the Pendulum?
You know that one?
I've heard of it. I haven't seen it yet, though.
You mean the one with Lance Hendrickson?
Yes.
Hmm. I thought you were talking about the Vincent Price one, but you're pretty close. I recall a couple of months ago that there was one particular flick you wanted to see on a poll I had, and it didn't win.
Oh, Meridian!
I figured it'd be a good opportunity to do so.
Wait a minute, where's the subtitle?
Yeah, that's the funny thing. You see, this movie had a lot of names as being distributed. In some cases it was Meridian, in other cases it was called Meridian Kiss of the Beast, The Ravaging, and strangely enough, Phantoms.
Act like you don't bomb in Phantoms, yo!
Yeah, that reference was too easy. Released in April 1990, Meridian, Kiss of the Beast was Full Moon Entertainment's second outing. Charles Band got the idea after being influenced by the Gardens of Bom Arzo, a famous Italian park that featured a variety of monsters depicted in stone statues. And fittingly so, given their surreal yet nightmarish quality. It was to be used for an Empire Pictures production called Bloodless, but the studio closed. Instead, it was refurbished into an erotically charged Beauty and the Beast fairy tale for adults.
Didn't Charles Band already do one of those?
Yeah, but that's when erotic adult musical fantasy movies were all the rave back then. The campy ones.
Cinderella!
Well, mine snaps and crackles, and mine pops.
Blame the 1976 Alice in Wonderland.
That exists?
You have no idea. Speaking of Empire Pictures, you had art director Giovanni Natalucci, Swedish film director Mac Ahlberg handling cinematography, Ted Nicolau doing editing duties, Dennis Pauly on screenwriting, Debbie Dio on development executive, Juliet Avil on post-production, and the Grim Reaper on bass cello.
You might be a king or a little street sweeper, but sooner or later you dance with the Reaper.
Okay, joking aside, some of these crew members would later work on other Full Moon entries, so you could say this is the last one to have the Empire Picture band together in one production. It was filmed exclusively in Italy, especially at the Castello di Giove Castle, which Band owned at the time. On top of that, you had Charles Band directing, making the first time in 5 years he directed something, not counting the aborted Pulse Pounders anthology movie. So you can imagine there's a lot riding on this one given the filming location and the familiar crew.
But it turns out good, right?
That's kind of the thing. I was previewing this movie a couple of months ago, and I had to duck out at one point to get a drink, so I only saw bits and pieces here and there.
Huh. Well, it can't be that bad. I mean, how can you screw up Beauty and the Beast? But I liked it.
Even the Emma Watson auto-tuning?
Not the auto-tuning. I felt like if they just let her sing naturally, she would have been fine. The small bits you heard her natural singing wasn't that bad. I mean, she's no Mariah Carey, but... In other words, don't do auto-tune.
Yes, thank goodness there's no singing in this one, so we'll see how it fares. Mm. And by the by, for this particular episode, we're going to be using footage from the Blu-ray remaster. The past two episodes, I've shown things from the VHS versions for better quality, and I would have had that option if I... didn't have any last-minute setups to do. That and also the VHS tape is buried deep in my closet somewhere.
Good idea.
Hey, at least we'll look nice, sitting the cinematography's beautiful.
After a spooky yet cool opening, with carnies emerging from another realm, we get introduced to our two leads, Catherine and her best friend Gina, played by Cheryl Flynn and Charlie Spradling. Catherine has inherited a castle in Italy after the passing of her father, while Gina is tasked to restore a particular painting that might be connected to this whole thing.
Just like old times back in the dorm.
Hardly, Kat. God, this is Italy. We made it.
Oh, come on. You were the best artist in that whole damn academy. But you should be painting, not restoring.
My God. Her acting is just... flat.
I mean, I know it's Charlie Spradling's first movie, but you gotta give her credit.
No, not her, the other one.
Cheryl Flynn?
Really? Yeah. I mean, she's pretty and all, and she's good at looking sad, but that seems that's all she's good at doing. Her acting in this film, to me, is just kind of, ugh. And the sad thing is, this isn't even her first film. I mean, I don't know if it's one of her earlier films, but... maybe she gets better the older she gets, but I'm not that impressed with what I'm seeing right now.
I don't know what's wrong with me.
Yeah, this was before Cheryl hit fame with Twin Peaks.
Daddy. From the bottom of my heart, I don't want to be the town bathing beauty.
Her early work includes a variety of B-movies, including 1986's The Wraith. She has admitted prior that she never took acting seriously until a certain erotic drama made her realize to take future in films seriously.
I'm afraid that superstition is beginning to run my life.
Be quick, someone's been killed. She's in the North Wing.
But that's been closed for years, ever since you left.
No, Martha, someone's there now.
I've never found much pleasure in illusion.
She did get better. It's hard to judge one on early roles, but I can say it's the character's aspects that limits her range. All I remember Catherine doing is appearing confused, crying when something supernatural happens, and looking mildly annoyed. For me, the problem in the performance is how the character is written. At least she has more range here than Kathy Ireland.
I'm gonna say dull surprise.
Dull surprise.
Dull surprise.
Yes.
Dull surprise. Dull surprise. Dull surprise. Dull surprise. Dull surprise. Dull surprise. Boy, I'm really making up the points. Dull surprise. Dull surprise. We'll be right back. Dull surprise. Dull surprise.
Still, I will give credit to Charlie Spradling. I do feel her better work is in Bad Channels and Puppet Master 2. Again, the script kind of limits what she can do. Her character is given an item of foreshadowing possibilities, and the only purpose she serves is to add unnecessary suspension. Honestly, if you cut her character out, little to nothing would change.
Yeah, I suppose, you know, you can't really judge her acting based off of this movie alone. It probably was because of how the character was written. I just really did not care for her acting in this flick. Anyway, they decide to make up for lost time and see a traveling sideshow in the park nearby. Before that, we get this bit of exposition about the castle.
What kind of weirdo built this place? Well, one of the stories is that back in the 1500s, a wizard created the castle out of a mountain, and then he turned his enemies into stone and put them here. The statue shows the curse of the person that sinned.
Well, it could be worse. We could be stuck in the audience.
Regardless, we get to see the traveling magicians, and as for their acts, well...
Thank you.
At one point, one of the Kearneys tries to get Catherine to take part in a knife-throwing act, but reluctantly declines, letting Gina take the stage instead. Foreshadowing, you say? This is soaking in it! After being impressed by an act that is on par with Spinal Tap opening for a puppet show, Gina offers the magic group to dinner at Catherine's home and,
Oh no.
What's wrong?
Well, this is where things get awkward.
Well, it's a B-movie, what do you expect?
Oh yeah, but here it kinda goes down a dark path it can't return from.
How dark are we talking? Sweeney Todd or Sleepy Hollow?
Baby, it's cold outside.
Oh, no.
Yep. While the group rudely feasts, one of the dwarf performers decides to spike Catherine Gina's wine, which starts to kick in faster than Hibernol.
Oh, I feel a cold and drowsy humor running through my veins, Obi-Wan.
My ass.
Yeah, it's going there. I'm never looking at the creeper from the Black Cauldron the same way again.
He voiced him?
Yeah, and another minor character from Willow. And I regret not bringing that up.
And it doesn't do any favors when the leader named Lawrence starts to have his way by removing her clothes, but instead decides to assault Gina while passing Catherine on to his twin brother.
Don't cry.
I mean, okay, maybe he's the good twin. I'll probably go in, save her, and...
Bad taste! Nope! Oh my god! Ah!
Oh, and for those wondering where the horror aspect kicks in, well... God. I just got it. This is what Chewbacca's grandfather was watching under that virtual reality helmet in the Star Wars Holiday Special.
Just for that joke, you leave me no choice.
What? Sleep! Where do I begin?
This is just so wrong on so many levels. Because the rape is done by the good twin. The twin that she's supposed to end up with at the end of the movie. The good guy.
I wanted to apologize. I know what we did was unforgivable. When I saw you from the stage, I seemed helpless.
I want you to leave.
It's like an apology does not make it right. Rape is rape. You shouldn't be romanticizing rape, because there's nothing romantic about getting raped. I mean, I get it, it's a product of his time, but to me, it just does not work. They should not have had him rape her. They should have had it be the bad twin raping her, or have it be that he stops the rape from happening, but he does it in his beast form, and maybe that's why she's afraid of the beast. But no, they have him rape her, and to me, it just doesn't work. It just doesn't.
Once you get beyond that, the rest of the movie focuses on Catherine experiencing a series of strange and spooky occurrences. One minute, she will see the ghost of a woman, and the next moment, the twins come back creating some psychological illusions. Either one of them will try to go after Catherine, or the other will turn into a beast and have Wookiee sex. Huh? Oh, this is where the trivia comes in. Well, apparently the beast makeup was done by Greg Cannon. While Greg's filmography is vast to mention here, one of his most notable work was in Coppola's Dracula Ware. Wait a minute, something's fishy here. Oh. Apparently, the Beast costume in Meridian was the same one used in Coppola's Dracula. All they did was just change the coloring. They did like this whole switcheroo thing without Coppola even noticing. Well, I'll give him credit for being creative. I mean, the fact that he did this behind Coppola's back, and to this day, Coppola does not know that they pulled this stunt. And I do think it's kind of funny because apparently Coppola never, to this day, found out that they used this costume in Meridian. As for the dream sequences with Catherine itself, it kind of does get into her mindset about what's going on. Like, you're not sure who she's supposed to think is good. I mean, I think she's kind of torn between the Beast and the twin, because when she does interact with the Beast in these scenes, he's not coming off as a quote-unquote Beast. Yet, when she comes across the bad twin, it's quite obvious that he's not exactly a good person. So you can kind of see the conflict there. Oh, and apparently there is a curse that is over the twins in the castle. Centuries ago, one of them killed the first lady of the castle, and her father cursed one of them to turn into a beast when they fell in love with someone.
Determination and self-sacrifice. Only someone who loves you can kill the beast. And you obviously do not love yourself. You're the Beast, Lawrence. You're the Beast.
Fine, whatever. I guess the only way to reverse the curse is to have someone love the Beast, and said lover has to kill the Beast.
You kill me.
No problem. The bad news is that your soul is extra crispy for damnation. The good news is that I'm free of your sorry ass. Can this movie get any stranger?
The boy, he brought the painting to the church. He said that the lady from the castle told him to bring it.
Oh, you must mean Martha.
Signorina, the English woman has been dead for 6 months.
What?
Why didn't you tell me?
For the same reason I couldn't let you see the painting. Or tell you the legend. You have to find out for yourself.
Really? Huh? This is stupid! That's it. I'm done. Awake. Awake. Awake! Why isn't this fucking working? Awake! Well, I guess I'm running solo for this one. Meanwhile, Gina is given a painting to restore and finds a cryptic message underneath. We keep cutting back to it after so many long stretches, and it's revealed to be the Beast aiming a crossbow at a woman that looks just like Catherine and one of the twins. I don't think paintings actually work like this when they were showing the restoration, because it's like, wouldn't the original image below be destroyed by all this? Although I find it oh so convenient that the character looks exactly like Catherine. Let's just skip ahead to the climax. So Catherine decides to... Ah! My lord! That is the ugliest dress I've ever seen! The red and gold just look so ridiculous together. Even Jennifer O'Connelly wore something less loud and subtle in the labyrinth. Even Guccio Gucci wouldn't allow this to be made. Anyway, Catherine decides to try and break the curse.
Lawrence is my brother. My name is Oliver.
Oliver? Oliver? What type of name is Oliver? This is supposed to be a gothic horror and the main guy's called Oliver? What? What about like Vincent? Or Dante? You know, a name that sounds like that area, not freaking Oliver? Oh, God, the sooner I get this done and over with, the better!
Yes. You are the one. So you must die.
Fool you!
Oh, how shocking. That That's right, folks. We've gone from twisted fairy tales to soap opera cliches. So Lawrence decides to kill Catherine, but Beast Oliver tries to fire an arrow and one of the carnies tries to stop him. Gina just happens to be there and recovers Oliver's crossbow.
And you're a horrible shot.
But, plot twist, the true beast that had to be killed was Lawrence this whole time. Again, how shocking. Thus, the curse on both twins is lifted, and Catherine ends up with her man, who date-raped her, I might add. Sorry to sour things and sound like a broken record, but this clearly doesn't warrant a happy ending when your love interest sexually assaulted your hero.
I wish there was some way to wake Sleeping Beauty down there. Oh, he's gonna hate me for doing this, but I don't have much of a choice. Oh, look! I'm about to have my picture taken with Estelle Ellis! I really hope someone doesn't miss this opportunity!
Crystal from Star Fox Adventures is here?
Where?
Oh, I must have missed her. Was she really nice in person? And I missed the movie, too. Talk about a double bummer. Thankfully, I think I've seen enough to form an opinion about this whole affair.
Oh, really?
As much as I want to say it gets my passive judgment, it's way, way too problematic for me to say it's okay.
For the most part, it has better technical work and better cinematography compared to Layer 2 movies. And Malcolm Jameson as the two twins is kind of interesting. He's able to play off the whole good and evil aspect, so he's able to show his dramatic chops in a way, and some of the dark fantasy does lead to a spooky yet unique atmosphere. However, there is one thing that kills it.
The hero ends up with someone who date raped her!
I'm sorry, but there is no way it would fly under the radar today. And we're not alone in this one, too. It's a shame to have a movie with unique ideas and look gorgeous get dragged down by a problematic element such as this. How can one find romance in date rape? That's just wrong.
Yeah, the thing is, you really can't. I mean, maybe you could possibly fall in love with someone who raped you, but it would take years and years and years of building up trust with said person, and even then I don't think it would be possible.
I'll give it this much, it's a better romance story than Endless Love or Twilight. Yeah. But it still doesn't even bring that fact away from it.
Well, again, if you ignore the rape, the fantasy elements were pretty good. I mean, again, I loved the castle that they filmed in. It was very gothic, it definitely had the atmosphere going. Acting, aside from Catherine, I did like. I felt like overall this film had potential to be a good film, but it just fell flat in certain places.
It's a bigger shame because I want to recommend this flick. But yet, when one hot topic element brings the whole show down, man, does it come crashing to the floor. If you want a better look at Full Moon's gothic horror, seek out The Pit and the Pendulum or the Subspecies trilogy. The only other piece of good I can say here is how this is a one-and-done film without any follow-ups. Your move, Shadowheart Curse.
Frankly, this movie was... It was okay, I guess. I think the real thing about it that really turned me off was the whole date rape scenario. Because if it was a deal that it was the bad twin who did that to her, that would have been fine. But the fact that the good twin partakes as well, it's like, no, how am I supposed to root for this couple? It's a toxic relationship. And that really brings the movie down. Morgan, are you okay? Well, it wasn't really that bad. I mean, we can always do another Full Moon feature. You gonna be okay? It's okay. It still wasn't all, man, so it's okay. We can still salvage this. You wanna watch, the sequels to Subspecies?
Until the end of time. I offer you a most precious gift.
Oh.
advantage the in-home cinema date, there's always a chance for a good backup plan.
Indeed.
Seems to have quite a history, Mr. Gallagher.
But they are playing with an evil force. Pinhead. Blade. Ms. Leech. Jester. And Tunneler. The Puppet Master.
First, they made you smile. And then, they made you die. And this time, their master is back, and Andre Toulon is proud to present the newest addition to his terrifying troupe. Puppet Master 2. His unholy creations hold the strings to your life.
I know how to get into things.
Cut.
The ring is a little different because it's going to be a... It's a love story.
Bull!
Well, just when you thought it was safe to turn off your VCR, I am here. Full Moon! That's right. I'm that heavenly body who orbits your video store, bringing fantasy and adventure to your otherwise dreary planet. Now that you've finished watching the movie, you're probably wondering, what else could you do for fun? You could rent another Full Moon video, guaranteed to be exciting. Some Full Moon collectibles. What are Full Moon collectibles, you ask? Take a look. Movie posters from all your favorites. Puppet Master, Shadow Zone, Meridian, and more. Now, if those don't grab you, how about these? Creeper Car, featuring some of the scariest scenes you'll ever see. They change right before your very eyes. Collect them all. Still not enough for you? Wait, there's more. Here's something you can't do without, the official Full Moon sweatshirt. Wear it everywhere and watch your friends work up a sweat. And that's not all. We have some unusual toys and collector's items just for you. Puppet Master Pad. Shadow Zone Lab Coat. And Slimer Timer. Crash and Burn Sunscreener. All you have to do is write for a free brochure. We'll even send you a Full Moon newsletter that tells you all about our upcoming films. Don't delay. Write today. Tell them Full Moon sent you.